My heart is broken, but I give you praise. Somebody open your mouth. It's a sacrifice now. Come on, let's break this atmosphere open. It's a sacrifice now. My heart is heavy. My heart is broken, but there's yet a praise in my spirit. I need to hear you. There's a sound that Bishop would want to hear in this room. Somebody throw your hands up and open your mouth and give God glory. Sing with me.
I vow to praise you through the good and the bad. I praise you.
Yes, I will. Y'all say,
whether high.
Everybody.
I will praise you.
It's what I do. It's what I do.
Welcome to a broadcast, the True Life Sanctuary. I'm your host, Pastor Tyrone L. Hughes. I want to bring you a powerful message today titled, Where Do We Go From Here? Have you ever been in a situation where you're wondering what's next? Have you ever been in a situation where you're going through troubling times economically? And you lost a job and you in between jobs, or your benefits has been cut off, and you're asking God and you're wondering, where do I go from here? Have you ever been in a relationship and given your all and you trusted the other individual and you thought they would never do what they done? And you find yourself on the wrong end of the relationship, whereas it was supposed to produce the fruit of happiness and love and prosperity and family, but yet you find yourself reaping a different type of harvest, one that you didn't sow seeds to get. You gave your all. You didn't play games. You were truthful. You were loving and kind and sweet. No, not perfect. No, with flaws and shortcomings, but yes, faithful and true, and gave your all. But yet, you find yourself crying, brokenhearted, tearful, trying to go day to day, and yet it doesn't make sense. And so you start asking questions, and you raise your children right. You've done all that you can do, but yet your child ended up shot, stabbed, in the penitentiary, on drugs. And you're saying, how did this happen? Where can I go from here? Many things happen in life and we question God. We have storms and floods and all type of natural disasters. And you say, well, God, you're in control. I've lost my home, I've lost my job, I've lost everything that I put my trust in. Where do I go from here? Going through the rubble of a tornado, of a hurricane, looking for memories, looking for pictures, looking for anything to remind you of what life once was. And you find yourself asking, where do I go from here? Where do I go from the rehab center? Where do I go from house to house living with relatives? Where do I go from drug addiction? Where do I go from losing relationships after relationships? I've been blessed with good people in my life, but yet, because struggling with a porn addiction, struggling with going to the strip club, struggling with gambling away finances that could have paid the bills and done something for your children, but yet you find yourself broke. You find yourself saying, I'll never do this again, but yet soon as the opportunity arises, there you go. Oftentimes, life brings us situations and we have no answers. We refuse to turn to something bigger than ourselves. We try to fix it with our intellect. We try to fix it through manipulation or hustling. We try to fix it with self-medication. We won't turn to the only source that can fix it. Even many of us in the church believe that we're given the Holy Spirit so that we can copy who Jesus is. The Holy Spirit was given to us so that Christ can live through us. The Holy Spirit was given to admonish, to correct, to lift up, and to teach, and to reveal truth so that we can understand the difference between truth and falsehood. But again, I ask, as we deal with this nation, as we deal with the troubles of everyday society, as we deal with the brokenness of humanity, as we deal with political scandals and deal with corruption, pedophilia in the church, as we deal with scams and hustles, as we deal with what people call global warming, but yet it's prophecy, as we deal with mothers abandoning children, children turning against mothers, men being lovers of themselves, men being lovers of pleasure, people doing any and everything for money, fulfilling what Jesus the Christ said when he said money is the root of all evil. The love of money. Because when you love money, understand the definition of love. For the Bible said, him who loveth not knoweth not God, for God is love. Therefore, if money is your God, it becomes the root of all evil because you think it is the cure-all. And therefore, there's nothing that you won't stoop down to any level to get it. We'll sell our bodies to get money. We'll sell drugs and poison millions of people to get money. We'll rob and steal and kill to get money. We'll cheat on our income taxes to get money. We'll gamble to get money. We'll do anything to get money. We'll enslave children to get money. We'll dance on a strip pole to get money. Because we believe that if we have money, it'll get us out of any situation. We believe that money can buy people, buy protection, buy security. That it'll buy us happiness because we got big cars and big homes and designer clothes. But it's unfortunate when we believe that by having someone else's name tag on our back, that that gives us identity. When God said we were created in his image and likeness. But yet we still, with all of these teachings going on today, we still find ourselves struggling with truth. And so we have to ask ourselves many times, where do I go from here? I'm in a situation where my bills, I got just enough money to pay the rent. Or to pay the mortgage, to pay the car note, to pay the insurance, to send the kids to school, to get gas money. But yet, when it's time to be obedient to Malachi 3, 8 and 10, we can't do it. We say, well, these things are under the law. But yet, Abraham tithed before the law. Understand, tithing is a principle that the lesser is blessed by the greater. Abraham sold into the pre-incarnate Christ, which we call Melchizedek, and understand by sowing into him, the Levites who were still in his loins was able to now correct tithes in the earth because Abraham has sowed in the spirit. And so we have to understand that tithing is a trust principle. Do you trust God to bring you a harvest where you have sown? Those who don't believe in tithing don't want to tithe, they don't trust God. But the same people trust the lottery ticket, trust the bingo card, trust fantasy football, trust the check and the cash places, trust Wall Street. Trust the loan shark, but won't trust the very creator who made you. God says that if you bring your tithes into a storehouse, then he open up the window and pour out a blessing more than you can receive. God says in Deuteronomy 8 and 18, remember the Lord thy God who give you power to get wealth so that he may establish the covenant that he made with your forefathers. God said in Deuteronomy 28 and 8, I will command the blessing over your finances. God said you will be blessed, pressed down, shaken over, and overflowing. God said that If you sow sparingly, you'll reap sparingly. If you sow generously, you'll reap generously. God said you will get 30-fold, 60-fold, 100-fold. God said, above all things, he wished that you should prosper and be in good health, even as thy soul prosper. God said the blessings of the Lord maketh rich. So when people say that this is a prosperity gospel, there's only one gospel, the gospel of Jesus Christ, and that gospel is a gospel of increase. The very first thing that God told us to do is to be fruitful. Fruit is a produce. It means to be productive. It means to increase. God says multiply. That means increase. When souls are won to the kingdom, that is increase. The angels celebrate increase. So Satan has duped you into believing that poverty is pious. Jesus chose 12 disciples. All of them were successful businessmen. Peter was just not a fisherman. He had a fleet of boats. He owned boats. Luke being a physician, Levi tax collector, Matthew an accountant. We look at all these men in the Bible that were wealthy. Abraham was wealthy. Isaac, Jacob, Job, King David, Solomon, and so forth. But if you want the truth of the story, you must go to the beginning of Genesis where Adam was given a land of gold and it was good. And so then, many of us are struggling today and under trying to figure out where will we go from here. The first thing we have to do, God said your treasure's where your heart is. Many of us are struggling in poverty in a situation because we have an impoverished mentality. We don't understand that we are kings and priests. We don't understand that we are the righteousness of God, that we are the head and not the tail, above and not beneath, that we're more than overcomers but conquerors. This is not a prophecy or a situation that's Jewish. This is a principle that God has released into the earth through an organic principle. You reap what you sow. If you have 10 acres and only sow 5, then you left half the field empty. So your harvest will be less than it should be. A lot of people don't believe this, but you control the size of your harvest. God will bring the rain and the increase. He's already made the soil with the nutrients that will give birth to the seed. Genesis 1:11 says the life is in the seed. So the problem with you not having increase and wealth in your life is because you have an impoverished mentality instead of having mental wealth. So where will we go from here as a culture of people, as a nation of people? When will we reunite? When will we be reconciled? For God has given us the ministry of reconciliation. He has restored us back to before the fall. As believers, we have to stop thinking of everything after the fall of Adam. God did not create us to live in a sin-sick world. God created us to live forever in his presence. And this revelatory truth is found in the first 3 days of creation. God said, let there be light. That word light means illumination. It means luminary in every sense. And so then light cast out darkness. So God is showing us our dominion over the enemy. The very first line in the Bible. For Thessalonians says, you are children of the day, not of the night. Therefore, God is showing us our rulership over Satan who had fell from heaven. Day one, day two, day three, when God said it was good, there was no sun, there was no stars, there was nothing to give us light in the natural sense. That didn't happen till day four. So how was there light? Because we were designed not to live by what we see with our eyes. We were designed to live by the illumination of God. And so the just live not by sight, but by faith. Faith in the finished work of God. This is why after the Sabbath, he said it was finished. After the sixth day, rather, he said it was finished and rested on the Sabbath. Adam did not begin his life working. He began his life resting in the finished work of God. And so Jesus also said, the hour has come. Now glorify me in the glory that I had before the foundation of the world. He said it's finished. So what was left undone? If God said it's finished, then why did Jesus say it's finished? See, the God of creation had done his work, but man had failed in doing his. And so now Jesus came in the form of man to be an example and show us how we should live. See, in order to be a great leader, we must also be a great follower. Jesus, in order to lead mankind, he had to follow the plan of salvation. And so you ask yourself again, whatever situation you're in, where do I go from here? The answer is always found at the cross. Now, the cross itself is not the blessing. For cursed is he who hang on the cross. For Christ became sin on the cross. That's not why we celebrate Christ. For many people have hung on the cross. But the blessing came in the resurrection. He resurrected with an incorruptible body. That's why he's called the first fruit of many brethren. That lets you know that there's many coming. That there's many that's going to follow after him. When he appear, we will look like him in an incorruptible body, for we will change in the twinkle of the eye. So where will we go from here? There's always another level, from faith to faith, line upon line, precept upon precept, glory upon glory. God has something for you today. There's always another place that for you to go. So all you have to do is put your trust in God's unchanging hand. He'll bless you like he blessed everybody in the scripture, for he is no respecter of persons. So no matter what you're going through, if you're sick in your body, you have to understand that God has given you a promise. He said, by his stripes, you are healed. Not will be, can be, but is. But do you believe it? Do you receive revelation? Do you receive truth? For the Bible says it is the truth that shall set you free. Not the truth I know, but the truth you have received. What is truth? If we study the book of John in the 17th chapter, the Bible says thy word is true. It is the word that became flesh and dwelt become among men. Jesus Christ is the truth. We know that Mary in a situation, she said, when they had ran out of wine and Jesus' first miracle, she turned to the people and said, do whatever he tell you to do. In other words, obedience will always bring you prosperity and bring you purpose in the process of your walk and sanctification with God. Obedience. Obedience is better than sacrifice. If you obey what God has said, then you will reap the promises of what God has promised. This is why we have conditional prophecies and predictive prophecies. Conditive prophecies is when God says, if you hearken unto my voice, you will receive this. If today you do this, you will receive this. Then there's other prophecies where God predicts the coming of Christ. It has nothing to do with us. God tells us that sky is going to split and we're changing the twinkling of the eye. That has nothing to do with us. So there's things that we have to enter into a covenant with God. And therefore, it will manifest in the earth. Jesus spoke things back into alignment in Matthew 6 and 10. He said, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. He was speaking alignment and speaking things back into existence, just like he spoke the world into existence. Let there be. And it was. So whatever you struggle with today, whatever you're going through today, and you find yourself asking, where do I go from here? Don't turn to crime and to try to make ends meet. Don't turn to things that's ungodly, trying to find pleasure. Don't turn to drugs and alcohol, trying to self-medicate. Where do you go from here? Sometimes you have to bottom out. Sometimes you have to come to an end to yourself, to where as you understand there's nothing I know to do. So now let me turn it over to him. And this is where your weakness becomes God's favor. Because in your weakness, his strength is made whole. Sometimes you have to be weak before you can be strong. Sometimes you have to be weak to understand that it's not about you. That it's bigger than you. That you need to humble yourself. That you need to turn to a higher power. That you need to let go and let God. For when the people of Israel came to an end of running from Pharaoh, there was nothing there but the sea. There was nowhere else they can go. Moses said, stand still and watch the salvation of the Lord. And God made a way. For he said, I will open doors that man cannot open and close doors that man cannot close. If you wondering where should you go from here, go to the cross. Go to prayer. Seek God. For he says, in all you're getting, get understanding. Wisdom is the principal thing. Wisdom is applied knowledge. So what do you know? Couples are struggling. Marriages are struggling. What does the word say? It says, be you not unequally yoked with unbelievers. Secondly, dwell with one another according to what? Knowledge. What do you know about this person? What do you know about their spirit? What do you know about their thought process? Because in order to be godly, Philippians 2 and 5, let the mind of Christ Jesus also be in you. So if you think like Christ, you will speak like Christ, and your behaviorism will be like Christ. You will reap the fruit and results of Christ. See, we have to move past just having faith in Christ. See, that's what gets you saved. That's saving grace. But the true definition of grace, charis, means the divine inspiration upon the heart that now reflects in your life. You can look it up in your Strong's Concordance. I know everybody tells you that grace means unmerited favor. That's saving grace. The real grace is the divine inspiration from heaven upon your spirit that now reflects in how you live. And so then, understanding that if we are to benefit from the gospel, then we have to live the gospel. We can't just talk the gospel. We have to be examples of the gospel. We have to reap what God has promised. So then we have to sow into one another with love. He says, love God with all thy heart, might, and strength, and love thy neighbor as you love yourself. If you don't love yourself, how are you going to love your neighbor? If you're full of bitterness and anger and doubt and unbelief, then how can you love somebody else the way God created you to when you're struggling with embracing yourself? Because you feel as though some of the things that you've done, that you're unworthy of love, that you're unworthy of blessings, you find yourself feeling like Mephibosheth. Mephibosheth had to wonder, where do I go from here? Here it is, King Saul and Jonathan both killed, and he's in the care of a nanny who drops him. See, what happens to the person who was entrusted into the hands of someone like a teacher, in the hands of an officer, in the hands of a priest, but yet were betrayed in the most ultimate way? The police who made vows to serve and protect you turn around and then held court in the street and shot you because you are the wrong ethnicity. Or because he perceived or think that you're no good, that you're a thug, that you ain't nothing, so he shot you. Or you took your child to a cathedral and trusted him for spiritual guidance, and yet he turned around and was molested. Or you took your son or daughter to a daycare center. Or a high school student that a teacher slept with. People in authority, but trust being betrayed in the most ultimate way. Then we find ourselves in shambles saying, where do we go from here? We see it in the news every day. We see it with people buying grades and paying for educations. We see it in immigration. People not allowed to come over here because of skin color, and with this whole nation, everybody over here is immigrants except for Afro-Americans that came over here in slavery. We see it every day in the news that people not running for office based on their abilities to perform, but they running on character assassination. We see it every day in the news, race wars. We see it every day in the news, countries at war. Where is the peace? Because we trying every way but God's way, which is through Jesus Christ, who is the Prince of Peace. So we find ourselves wondering, where will we go from here? The answer is clear. It's at the foot of the cross. Jesus says, whosoever will, let him come. And I know I make this statement and it may sound weird, but it's truth. For God is promiscuous with love. He says, whosoever will, let them come. But God only gives himself in right relationships. For the bride of Christ is who he's intimate with. And through the bride of Christ, does he give birth in the earth to his purpose. He do not fornicate with the mistresses of false religions. See, God's grace, once again, unmerited favor, is things like 90 degrees. See, it's 90 degrees for the drug dealer, for the pedophile, for the stripper, or for the man of God. For it rains on the just as well as the unjust. But his blessings is for his children. So if you bless today, then the question is, why are you not turning to the God of creation? Why are you asking questions on what can I do? God said, take no thought for what you shall eat, what you drink, what you wear. Only pagans do that. Why? Because pagans have no relationship with God. So if you understand your sonship, understand your inheritance, he said, him that is a son is a co-heir of Christ. Therefore, you are heirs of the kingdom. Whatever Christ have, we have. You know, I've been at times wondering myself, where do I go from here? Been in many situations. Where do I go from here? Thinking that it's over, the enemy being accused of another brother. You're no good. You know, you're not going to do this. You can't have this because you did this. Remember you did that? You thought that just yesterday. See, all he want to do is always bring accusations and make you think you're not good enough, make you think that you're not worthy, and make you doubt God's promises. But the thing is, your own righteousness is filthy rags. According to whatever you do, he's right. You're not good enough. But when you understand that Christ, your life is hid in Jesus Christ, that he has covered you in his blood, then now everything that you have a right to, because God has promised you, you're not blessed by performance, you are blessed by position. And this is the beautiful thing of understanding the gospel. This is understanding you have a legal right, for God is a God of law. If it is not in his law, in his word, then you cannot have it. You cannot claim something that you don't have a legal right to. Understand, Jesus didn't abolish the law. He fulfilled the law. So therefore, by being in Christ, you was like you kept the law yourself. So everything within the law, you now can receive. So don't believe the enemy. When he tricked you, that's why Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. That's the Decalogue. That's law. He said, the law was written upon my heart so that I may not sin against you. What law? If there's no law, what law do you write upon your heart? If there's no law, then you can't say anything to the homosexual, for that's Leviticus 18:22 is the law. Are we okay for us to murder? Is it okay for us to commit adultery? Is it okay for us not to keep a Shabbat? Is it okay for us to dishonor our mother and father? If we say there's no law, then what are we doing here? Sanctification and holiness is of God. And so then, the problem is, where do we go from here? First of all, is that the steps of the righteous is ordered by the Lord. Many are the plans of man, but God leads. God ordains. God already has a purpose. He told Jeremiah, before you in your mother's womb, I knew you. God has already created us in the image of his son, Jesus Christ, and he will perform that work until his coming. So again, when we ask ourselves, where do we go from here? Everybody's here is a different place. Your here could be from the projects to an apartment, from an apartment to a house. Your here could be from a drug addiction to being sober 1 week to sober for 30 days. Your here could be from going from separation or divorce, from being reconciled and being happy. Wherever your here is, you advance from there, go to the Word of God. Find out that situation in the Bible. What did God say about it? What are you entitled to according to his word? And stand on it. Believe God. But see, this is, again, us not understanding prayer. And this is something I asked God about. I said, why is it that your word says, watch this, that God already knows what we need even before we pray? God is all knowing, so we can't give him new information. Therefore, what's the purpose of prayer? If God knows what I need before I pray, he's Alpha and Omega, beginning and end, he's preordained things for the kingdom, then why pray? See, prayer is actually speaking things into creation that is not present in your life, but was promised to be in your life. Prayer is moving into agreement with what's already been settled in heaven, Psalms 119, 89, and 90. Prayer is speaking words that release power. For the power of life and death is on the tongue. Prayer is moving into agreement with the intercessory Lord. This is what prayer is all about. And we see this powerful thing happening in the third hour, the sixth hour, and the ninth hour in scriptures. You have to study these things out. It's a powerful revelation. The hour of creation, the law of sacrifices, the law of burning the incense, the hour of prayer, all is at the same exact time. The lamb was slain in the morning and the evening, the same morning and the evening when God created creation. The incense in the temple were burned in the morning and the evening. Manna was dropped. The law was given during the same time. Jesus was on the cross during the same time. Peter received his revelation to go to the Gentiles during the same time on the roof and was verified and confirmed by Cornelius during the same time. Because David prayed these three times. Daniel prayed these three times. Because they understood that there is a principle for everything we do in the kingdom. God is right in his act. He is true indeed. So therefore, if you look at these sacred anointed times when God prayed, when something happened to Ezra, when the people were mixing with other cultures and marrying foreign wives, Ezra ripped his clothes in chapter 9, but he waited until the hour of prayer, knowing that he would receive. See, we have to have a spirit of expectancy, believing that God would do what he said he'd do. God would do what he promised. God will always do what he has spoken. He is not a man that he should repent, on man that he should lie. So the question is, where do you go from here? Make your mind up that today, like he said, today is the day of salvation. What you confess in your heart, believe in your heart, and then confess with your mouth unto salvation. So that means you have to believe, you have to confess, and you have to speak it out loud. Jesus said, confess me before men, I confess you before the Father. Again, you have to speak it. Show me one time in the Bible where Jesus didn't use this principle. He said, say unto the mountain, be ye removed. He called Lazarus out of the grave. He said to the woman, issue blood, your faith has made you whole. Jesus said to the cripple, stretch forth thy hand. Jesus said to the sea, peace, be still. Jesus spoke. Why? Because John 6:63 says, the words that I speak are both spirit and life. This is what we have to understand. That the word is power. And so we must release it. So again, if you find yourself wondering, where do you go from here? Go to the word of God. God loves you. God is merciful. God is not trying to judge you or condemn you. God is calling you back unto himself. The three angels' message, which many are afraid to preach, Christ in his second coming, but it's not about preaching hellfire, damnation, torment. It's about letting people know that the hour is coming where the window will close. Just like Noah's ark, it closed and then the rain came. The time, the period of grace, the dispensation of grace will close. And Christ will return. But the opportunity that will be lost, yes, there's consequences for sin, but that's not even the issue. The issue is the opportunity that will be lost is the great opportunity of receiving the love of Jesus Christ, receiving salvation and eternal life, and being able to spend eternity with your grandmother, your mother, your kids, your ancestors, with Jesus himself, being able to see his face and look at the person who loved you so much that he gave his very life for you. Why lose such a great opportunity when you can come to God right now under the sound of my voice? So the answer to where will we go from here? Heavenly Father, we thank you for this opportunity, for all those who struggle with the question of where do they go from here in the whatever situation that they're in. Heavenly Father, that your healing hand touch the sick right now, Lord, for by your stripes they are healed. Heavenly Father, your hand of provision touch those who are struggling with poverty. Heavenly Father, you said you wish that it is not your will that man should be alone. Heavenly Father, so you bring help meets and bring royal couples together, kings and queens to represent your kingdom, Lord, in marriage. Heavenly Father, you are a way maker. Lord, people that are struggling with what to do next. Struggling with how can I put this thing down. Well, Lord, just touch them with your conviction, Lord. Touch them with your Holy Spirit, Lord. Give them a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge, Lord. Thank you for your fruits of the Spirit and gifts of the Spirit, Lord. Thank you for everything that you do for us. You know, in the scriptures, there's a person that said, help my unbelief, Lord. So many people need that done. Because once again, like Mephibosheth, when King David called to restore everything that was rightfully his by law, he said, what do you want? With such a dead dog as I. He thought that he was unworthy as a grown man based on something that happened to him when he was 5 years old. Many people have been molested and hurt and abused and in prison and so many things that happened to them when they're young, whereas today they feel they're unworthy. But yet, The doors of the church is always open. Upon Jesus' resurrection, the first thing he said was, tell my disciples and Peter. Why? Because Peter, even though he had cut a man's ear, even though he had cussed a lady out, even though he had rejected God, Jesus said, let Peter know that the doors of the church is open. So I know Peter was wondering, where do I go from here? Thinking, now I've rejected my Lord, I done turned my back on only thing that represented life, but yet here comes Jesus said, no matter what you've done, there is a place that you still can come. For my arm is open, I did not come to condemn or to judge, I came to restore you to love. So where do we go from here? Heavenly Father, as a nation, a lot of people are asking that question. Approaching this 2020 election, they're saying, where do we go from here? Who do we choose? Once again, we put in our trust in the wrong thing. Heavenly Father, let us turn to you. The military can't protect us, but you have a legion of angels that can. A new president can't make the economy better. Heavenly Father, we have a different system. That if we deposit our seed and trust in you, Heavenly Father, you said we'll be like the tree that should not be moved, planted by the waters, that we will reap in due season, and that our leaves shall not wither even in the time of famine, because we trust in your system. So, Heavenly Father, let us reflect who you are on this great light of the gospel. For we love you and we thank you, because Jesus Christ is where we go from here. God bless you. Thank you for tuning in to the True Life Sanctuary. I hope you've got something from this message. God loves you. Amen.